Now, speaking at a rally in North Carolina this week, Donald Trump responded to Iran's plots to assassinate him. Let's have a listen.
But if I were the president, I would inform the threatening country, in this case Iran, that if you do anything to harm this person, we are going to blow your largest cities and the country itself to smithereens. There would be no more threats. But right now, we don't have that leadership or the necessary people, the necessary leaders.
You know, he's essentially saying, drop the bombs. What do you reckon?
Well, look, I perfectly understand his anger. I mean, how many of us out there, you know, have had assassination attempts against them by foreign governments? Not many. And, you know, there could be one or two from Iran. I mean, there was one back in July from Iran that was briefed out by I think there was a case actually from the Justice Department here. They actually brought charges to certain people. And then I think more recently, the Trump campaign has just announced that there was another such plot, I think a second such plot from Iran. So clearly, you know, I mean, clearly that country is up to no good in relation to its attitude to former President Trump. And I'd be pretty furious too. I mean, whether or not the US would, you know, would bomb the country to smithereens, I don't know. But I certainly understand. I certainly understand Trump's anger, and you know, more broadly in relation to Trump. I mean, he's had two real assassination attempts on him now, just in a few months. And actually, I think he deserves credit really how he's handled them in recent months. I think he's been quite courageous and a brave, you could almost say, the way he's kind of brushed them off. There's a strong likelihood, you'd have to say, there's going to be another real threat kind of in the next 5-6 weeks. Where there's a will, there's a way, and I think he deserves credit for how he's handled it.
Yeah, I'd be surprised if there wasn't another threat. And of course, we know with Trump, and it seemed to work during his last presidency, was that he has all the bluster, which I assume he uses in his quote-unquote diplomatic endeavours, but he doesn't necessarily always follow through with them. It's more threat than anything, but it's the unpredictability that works for him. And while we're talking about Trump, he pledged this week that if elected, the US will take other countries' jobs. He's laid out this plan for a manufacturing renaissance. Let's have a listen.
We're going to bring thousands and thousands of businesses and trillions of dollars in wealth back to the good old USA. That's what we're going to do. We're going to be doing it and doing it fast. And I want German car companies to become American car companies. I want them to build their plants here. I want to beat China in electronics production, and we'll be able to do that easily.
Now, all of this relies on tax breaks for companies that come and set up in America and heavy tariffs on companies that refuse to. If it works, it's brilliant. If it doesn't work, it does mean higher prices for Americans.
Yeah, look, certainly that's right. I mean, I certainly credit his aims and his desire. I mean, you know, kind of everyone in America would like to bring back those manufacturing jobs. If you look at the manufacturing jobs totals over the last 25, 30 years, you see this extraordinary drop-off. Basically, the US lost a third of its manufacturing jobs just in a few years after the year 2000, when there was a general liberalization of trade. And those jobs have not come back. So they have not come back. I mean, I think it's going to be very hard for a future Trump administration to unscramble that egg. I mean, even though he's announced, as you point out, he's announced various higher tax rates on companies that move their operations overseas. I mean, I think, you know, legally you can do it, but I think once you introduce those sort of distortions into the tax system, you get all sorts of gaming by companies of them, and therefore, you know, and then the tax differences don't actually achieve their aim. But I mean, this is a very technical area. I mean, his policy to increase tariffs across the board by at least 10% is indeed a revolutionary policy in global trade. I mean, no one's done anything like that for many, many decades, and we don't know. You know, we really can't. We can't predict what impact it's going to have. I mean, it does depend on the individual good in question and whether or not the tariff is borne by Americans or it's borne by the foreign exporter. And it's hard to say generally how that's all going to work out. But look, I admire Trump's aim, but look, it could be a rocky, you know, rocky few years if he's re-elected for global trade. And that's, you know, that's particularly bad for Australia too, because we're a relatively small country. We trade a lot, and we really don't want to see a general increase in tariffs throughout the world.
We shall see. Adam Creighton, thank you so much for your time.